Lord, we give you glory, we give you praise. Thank you, God, for all you have done. Lord God, we come on this morning praying for your word to go forth, and not only that your word will go forth, also that your people will receive your word. For Lord God, we thank you for just being God all by yourself. And we ask, oh God, in the name of Jesus, that you have, as you have done in time past, that you will confirm thy word with signs, wonders, and wonders and miracles, oh God, in the name of Jesus. We give you glory, we give you praise, in the mighty name of Jesus, all the people said, amen. Turn with me to Luke chapter 15. Luke chapter 15, starting at verse 11. Luke chapter 15, starting at verse 11. And it reads, "And he said, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to the father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with righteous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in the land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into the fields to feed swine. And he would have famine filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he had came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father have bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger? Yes, I will rise and go to my father, and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me one of thy hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. And bring hither the fatted calf and kill it. Let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry." Those who have an ear, let them hear what the Spirit of the Lord has to say. And I thought with the nature of this text, that our subject matter is talking about a runaway child running wild. A runaway child running wild. We will find that the nature of this text, or the nature of the chapter, is that Jesus had to illustrate among the Pharisees and the scribes who were murmuring about Jesus, who was often hung out with publicans and sinners, and that the church leaders, they murmured and talk about and complained why Jesus will hang out with the publicans and sinners, because nobody really liked hanging out with the publicans and sinners and the tax collectors. But what the Pharisees and scribes, they didn't realize was that Jesus, that he came for the least and the lost. And isn't that kind of like a foreshadowing, if you will, about how things are nowadays, that we have so many people in the body of Christ who think that they are so anointed and so holy that all they want to do is hang around those who were deemed, if you will, be Christians or part of the body of Christ. But I share notice with you this morning that if that's your nature, what you think that your mission is, that you are missing the whole impact of why, one of the reasons why God really saved you, because he saved you in essence that you may be a vessel in which that God would draw others unto himself through you. So how then can we evangelize, or how then can we draw others who are lost, that draw them into the body of Christ, or even to invite them to our local church to where they can meet Jesus for themselves? Because if you think about it, yes, because you have not been saved all your life. Somebody along the line had to introduce you to Jesus so you get to know him for yourself. But just as the Pharisees and the scribes has been leaders of the church, that was murmuring because Jesus hung out and talked with publicans and sinners. So in the nature of this text and following, that Jesus had to give this parable, or these parables, if you will, to illustrate to the Pharisees and the scribes that whenever a lost soul is saved, that there ought to be some kind of rejoicing, because when there is one who is saved, the angels in heaven rejoice as a soul that has been saved. Because when you think about it, that Satan is on a rampage trying to gather up all who he can to go into the Satan kingdom. And if you don't believe it or not, or if you don't want to believe it, that just hell exists just like heaven exists. God, Satan exists just like God exists. And quiet as it is kept, and people don't talk much about it, but God created Satan because he was one of the divine, one of the best angels that God had made. But he had entered into pride, and ultimately through his pride that God had ejected and rejected and kicked Satan, Lucifer, out of heaven to where now he has his kingdom. But he knows that his time is running short, and he's trying to gather up everyone for whom he can get. So Jesus had bring about this illustration, this parable, or these parables of a lost sheep, lost coin, and a lost son, that to bring about there ought to be some form of rejoicing. Let me put it to you like this. Have you ever misplaced something and you don't know where it is, and you looked all over the house for it, but then when you decide that you wasn't going to look anymore, it just showed up and you ran across that in which you was looking for, and when you found that in which you were looking for, there was some form of rejoicing. So that's how it is when there's a lost soul that is saved, that has been lost into the world, that whenever someone give their life to Christ, there should be and there ought to be some form of rejoicing, because one is an advancement for the kingdom of God, and that is one soul that the Satan will not get hold of. So through the murmuring of the leaders of the church at that time, Jesus gives this form of this parable. Looking at this parable as dealing with this lost son, which ultimately gives illusion, if you will, that one, the Father, as being our Heavenly Father, and then you have two different sons, if you will, one who left on his own, then there was one that stayed home. And ultimately, that the one that is left home, they call a prodigal. But let me tell you that you don't have to leave home to be a prodigal. He could stay right there and still not be a part of the family or be a part of that particular, if you will, the local church. Let me put it to you like this, that there are some who have given their life to Christ that ultimately end up leaving the church, but then there are some who have given their life to Christ, but they stay in the church, but they are not part of the church. So then there's an allusion to that ultimately one is the Gentiles and one is as it relates to Jews. So then Jesus given this illustration to the Pharisees, and Luke said there was a man that had two sons. So then ultimately, as the Apostle Paul talked about the first Adam and the second Adam, the first Adam that through his own disobedience to God, that sin was born into the world. But then with the second Adam of Jesus Christ, and that when you believe in him, that you are saved from the penalties of sin. So he said a certain man had two sons, and then there was a younger and there was an older son. But the younger son was starting to, he started to feel himself. He started to feel like he's a little grown up, and now he had friends, if you will, that were off into the world doing their own thing. So now that he didn't want to go by the rules of his father's household anymore, and he asked the father, if you will, that you give me. He didn't ask, but he demanded that the father would give him the portions of good that fallen to me. He said, "Father, give me the portions of good that fallen to me." And you have to be careful of the decisions that you make, because the decision you make, if you don't make good decisions, they often have repercussions. He wanted to venture out into the world and see what's going on, and he demanded that his portions be given unto him. You see, there was a rule in the Jewish custom that ultimately the inheritance would not be given unto the sons until they reach a certain age, and the most of it would go to the eldest son. But this younger son, he wanted to go out and he wanted to do his own thing, and he said to the father, he demanded of him that he would give him his portion. And I think I need to share the notice with you this morning is that we have so many people nowadays, they are more concerned about their destiny and their blessing till they figure that God owed them something because they dare to try to live right. And I think I need to share, God, he doesn't owe us anything. And when you are a child of God, you should want to live right. You should want to do God's will. You should want to show how good God has been to you. God, he gave his very best unto us when he has given his only begotten son to die for our sins. And he raised him from the grave that third day morning with all power in his hand. And now he is sitting on the right hand of the Father. So he demanded that he would give him his portions. But with the wisdom of the Father, you know, sometimes experience is the best teacher. He did not argue with his son, but what he did, he departed and gave him his portions. You see, the father already knew what the world was all about. The father already knew that at some point that his son would realize and would be coming on back home. So then, what is that saying? Sometimes there are some folk that you just cannot argue with, you know, and particularly nowadays, it seems like with the younger generation that they know everything and you can't tell them anything. And sometimes you just have to let them go out there and experience it for themselves, because this world is not made up, is not what it used to be. The world is not what it cracked up to be. And I'm going to tell you that this generation that's coming up, all they are going to have is God. And you know, because there is so much going on. But this younger man, he made a decision, and he demanded of his father, of his substance, and then of his inheritance. And so then he didn't know how to do any kind of budgeting, but he did not know how to be responsible. But he went on out there and into the world, and he started packing his things, and he gathered all his stuff together, and he went into a foreign country, and there he had a party. He had a good time. The Bible said that he spent his living righteously, with righteous living. So he's out there having a good time, and you know, and that's how Satan is. Satan will set you up with a good time. How many of us know that Satan will set you up with a good time? That he will give you everything that you want to have, and he just set you up. He set you up for one for failure, and then once he gets you, he ain't gonna let you go. So you have to be careful of the decisions that you make, and how far you decide you want to move from home. You see, if you decide to leave home, it's best to leave there on a good note, because you just never know. You just might end up back there. How many of us know that you could end up back where you started from? So then he went there, and he had a good time. He had all kind of friends all around him. He had money in his pocket, and he splurging there in the world. How many of us know that you have all kind of friends as long as you got money in your pocket? How many of us know that you have friends around you as long as you're on a mountaintop? How many of us know that you have all kind of friends around you when things are going well? And I think I need to share notice with you. There is a difference in having a friend and associates. You see, associates only come around you when you're having a good time. Associates only come around you when you got money in your pocket. Associates only come around you when you are doing well. Associates is only coming around you when you don't need anything. But I dare to tell you, but a friend will stick with you through thick and thin. A friend will stick with you when you got money in your pocket. A friend will stick with you when you're broke. A friend will stick with you when you're on the down. A friend will stick with you when you are up. How many of us know the friends are few and in between? You'll be blessed if you have two good friends in a lifetime. You know, so then this young man, he went out there. He's having a good time. He is partying every weekend. He is going to the club. He's club hopping every weekend. He's spending all his money righteously. He's spending his money on drinks and everything, and having a good old time. But what he does not realize is that a good time only lasts for a short time. How many of us know that all good things must come to an end? You see, Satan is setting up a trap for him. He's out there having a good time. You see, he's out there, and now that he done spent all his money, now that he has spent everything that he had, look at him. The Bible says that a famine came in the land. So what he mean? Everything he's broke now, and now a famine come in the land. He's not able to buy food. He's not able to survive. He's not able to make it through the famine. And guess what? When he called all his little friends, they were nowhere around. Isn't that how it works sometimes? That when you need a helping hand, that nobody can be found. When you need somebody to help you pay your bills, there is nobody around. When you need a roof over your head for a little short period of time, guess what? There's nobody around. So this young man has spent everything that he had, and now there's nobody around to give him a happy hand. You see, that come from a decision that he made. He want to get up, he want to pack up, he want to leave, and he want to get out. And now he can't find anyone to help him. But he, at least this young man, at least he decided to go out and get a job. He decided to go out and get a job. He had pride. He was a prideful person. He didn't think all these things were supposed to happen to him. How many of us know that there are so many people in our world, so many people even throughout the body of Christ, that figure that nothing is supposed to happen to them? I tell you that you weep what you sow. Everything that you weep, you will sow. And the harvest is greater than what you have wheat. So then there was a mighty famine, but this young man, he decided to go and join himself with a citizen. And now you will find that the text indicates that Jesus had illustrated that this younger person may have been of Jewish descent, because when he found a job, that the citizen had put him in the pig pen. And you know, Jews had nothing to do with pigs. We put him down in the swine pit, and to where that he had to take care of something that he was banned from doing. But you know, that was a pivotal point in this little young man's life, because it took the pig pen experience for him to turn around. It took the pig pen experience for him to acknowledge what he had. It took the pig pen experience for him to come back to himself. It took the pig pen experience that he may get off his pride. You see, sometimes God has to allow us to have a pig pen experience. Sometimes God will allow you to live out the decision that you have made. He will let you go down that road, and you know that road will lead you into a pig pen. But sometimes a pig pen experience is the best thing for us. You see, when you have pride, God know how to abase you. When you have pride, God know how to humble you. And it took this pig pen experience that this young man may be humble. Now check this out. He was down in that pig pen. He was starving, that he was hungry. He didn't know where his next meal was going to come from. He didn't know which way to go. And he saw that the pigs were eating better than he was. And he decided that he wanted to eat what the pigs were eating, because he was hungry. I tell you, people, that when you are hungry, it tends to bring about a whole sense of reality in your life. It will cause you to remember the things that you used to do. It will cause you to remember the things that you used to have. You see, the young man, and he was down in the pig pen, and he wanted to eat what the pigs were eating. And then he started to remember the things that how Lord he had on the home front. He saw that the pigs were eating better than he was. And then he looked back over his life, and he saw how well he had it. at his home. He remembered how well he had it at his father's house. Now check this out. He is in the pen, but at his father's house, he had a roof over his head. He's down in the pen, but at his father's house, he had a nice soft bed to lay in. But now he's in the pen. But when he reflect on what he had at his father's house, he remembered that he could go into the food pantry and be selective of the kind of food that he wanted to eat. And then he was able to go in the refrigerator and see some leftover he could have eaten. But then right there, he is looking at the swines eating better than he was eating. But then as he was thinking about what he had at his father's house, he said, how many servants do my father have that have food to eat and then some to spare? And you know, that's how it is. You know, when you are halted on your pride, God will bring ways to bring you down. You see, he thought about how well he had it. And then he made up in his mind that the Bible says that he came to himself. The question is, do you know who self is? Do you know who you are? So that you may have a self to come back to. So then he said, the Bible says that he came to himself. He came back to his identity. He made one decision that got him into the situation. And now he's getting ready to make another decision to get him out of it. You see, the first decision caused him to commit sin. But the second decision that caused him to repent of his first decision, he said, I shall arise and get up from here and go back to my father's house, and I will tell him that I have sinned against heaven and against thee, and I am no more worthy to be called thy son. You see, now he is now in the stage of repenting and humbleness. And he got up from that pen and started making his way back home. There are some decisions that you might have made that cause you to lose everything, but you don't have to stay there. You don't have to stay like that. You don't have to stay in that pig pen. You don't have to stay empty. You don't have to stay in that remorseful state. You don't have to stay in that guilty state. You see, the devil, what he tries to do, he tries to bring about a sense of guilt to keep you down in the pig pen. On this morning, that you don't have to stay in that pit. You see, you have to make up in your own mind that you will return back unto God. And that's what this is all about. That this young man is going back to his father. And I tell him that God is standing waiting on you to come on back unto him. So then, as he was going back unto his father's house, he was rehearsing what he might say to his father. When he left, he had a pocket full of money, but now he's going back. He has broke his arm. left. He had a nice pair of shoes on his feet, but as he was going back, he wore holding those shoes. And when he left, he had plenty of clothes to wear, but now as he is going on back, he just had the clothes on his back. When he left there, he smelled like Irish Spring, but now as he's going on back home, he's smelling like he been in the pigpen. I think I need to share notice that no matter what you appear, no matter what your appearance may be, God, he is ready and willing to receive you just as you are. You don't have to be all dressed up. You don't have to be all smelling all good. You don't have to try to get your life together, because if the truth be known, you cannot get it together by yourself. He shall come on home. You cannot get your life together. You see, since Jesus died on the cross, that means he died for the drug addict. He died for the alcoholic. He died for the prostitute. He died for the slanderer. He died for all mankind. And that's some nasty stuff. But God will put his arms around you. You see, this young man is on his way back home. And yes, and I could imagine every day that this young man was gone, that the father would stare out the window, hoping that his son would come on back home. You see, God is waiting for you to walk down the road So now, this young man is on his way back home, weary, worn and sad, but he's gone on back home. While he was yet a great way off, the father looked out the window, and he saw an image that shaped like him. He saw an image walking down the road that walked like him. He saw an image walking down the road that was looked like him. And then I can imagine that this father, when he saw his twin walking down the road, he got excited. Yes, yes, he got excited, and he didn't wait for his son to make it back home. What he did, he ran out that door where his son is, and the Bible said he put his arms around him, and he kissed him, and he walked him on back home. I think I need to share notice with him that no matter what your appearance is, the Lord, he will put his arms around you. I tell you, you take one step, he will take two, and he's not gonna let you walk by yourself, but he will walk with you the rest of the way. How many of us know that if you make a step towards God, then he will meet you and bring you home back in? And then the father was so excited until the Bible says he started rejoicing at his son. His servants, get the best robe and put it on my son, and put a ring on his finger,
up and kill the fatty calf. It's time to rejoice that my son had come on back home. He once was lost, but now he's found. I tell you, the Lord will put a robe of righteousness on you, and then he will put the ring of the Holy Ghost on you to remind you that you who you are. He will remind the devil in hell that you are his child. And then they started a barbecue. They started the barbecue, and then they started drinking and having a good old time, and they rejoiced that the son had came on back home. And I think I need to share no desire that whenever anyone come on church ought to be excited. The church ought to be happy. The church ought to be rejoicing. The church ought to praise God. The church ought to be thankful that someone had come on back home. Is there anyone here who know that God, he will wrap his arms around you and bring you on back home? Escort you to the place you need to be. You're a child of God. He made you priests and kings. Is the all right? I tell him, there's nobody like God. You'll see when you fall down on your face, your friends will leave you alone. But when you fall down, God will pick you right on up. As one songwriter said, we fall down, but we get up. I tell him, you're gonna have to get up and dust yourself off and get on back home. Is the God all right? If you know God is all right, let me say yes, yes, oh, oh, oh yes.
Amen.
A runaway child running wild, but you can't run so wild where God won't receive you. We are extending the invitation. We are extending the invitation. And if you're looking for a church home and you would like Rhema Faith Ministries to lead your church home, this is the time to come. Or even if you come by letter, Christian experience, or candidate for baptism. So this will be your time to come. One away child run away. But yet, however he left and however he returned, he was received of the Father. And that's how the body, that's an example that Jesus had given to the Pharisees and scribes. And that's the example that we all must take when the morning comes. And I tell you, we are on the brink of what the Lord is ready to do.